God for the woman of God on last night, because everything she did was unorthodox. So it allowed me to know that it's okay to be different this morning. I just need y'all to work with me for a few minutes. I'ma say my Easter speech and we gonna go home. Well, excuse me, move on to the next session. Now, I was asked the task to talk about relationship. And I was like, God, why me? Why relationship? Because, you know, when you hear the word relationship, you think about marriage, you think about dating. You know, there's different sources of relationship. But the relationship I come to talk about today is friendship. Us as women, we don't have good friendship. Because sometimes we get intimidated by the next lady. Or sometimes we get upset because we're wondering, why did they choose them and not me? We become intimidated, and we don't use the word friendship seriously like we're supposed to. We say everybody is our friend. Oh yeah, right, and it's the new thing. Hey friend, and I don't even know your name. But I'm your friend. The Bible says in Proverbs 18 and 24, the Message Bible. I'm going to walk, y'all got to walk with me just for a few minutes. It says, a friend comes and friends go, but a true friend sticks by you like family. Yeah. See, when you're my friend, if I'm going through, you there. When you're my friend, nobody should be able to tell if you're my sister biologically or spiritually, because you're my friend. You shouldn't be able to identify or be able to figure out where we come from, because we're just that close. That's what happens when you're friends. See? But we want to call everybody friend. We want to, oh, that's my friend and she don't even know your name. Or, oh, that's my friend and you haven't even dealt with me in my dark place. See, a real friend will deal with you in a dark place. In a place where you don't want to be bothered at. A real friend will deal with you when you don't want to be bothered with yourself. A real friend will deal with you when you don't even understand what God is doing in you. So you find yourself lashing out at everybody. They don't take it personal. They just go and pray because they're friends. My problem is we take everything personal. We operate in our feelings, our emotions as women. We got to get out of our emotional state. Because we're women, you know, we're nourishers, so we become emotional creatures. Oh, she don't like me. Really, it wasn't had nothing to do with you. It has everything to do with what I'm dealing with. But if you was my friend, you would understand what's going on the inside of me. Because we're friends. See, a close friend know more about you when you forgot about who you are. Oh, what do you mean about that? I mean this right here, when I'm finna go out here and do something real dumb, and you look at me and you be like, girl, now you know better than that. That ain't you. Help, Pastor T, help. Now, why are you walking around here acting like that? Get yourself together. That's what a real friend does. But we play, and I look at you. And then I go back and talk to old girl about what you're doing. And then I get back in your face and I, girl, it's gonna be all right, but you're supposed to be my friend. I'm so glad I don't have them shady friends. That's why my friends are far and near. I have a bunch of associates, but I don't have a lot of friends. See, that's a difference between an associate and a friend. An associate is somebody that you deal with on a casual basis, but a friend you deal with all the time. Oh, y'all will catch me. I understand. I'm going to get up and I'm going to hurry up and I'm going to get out your way. But this, we're talking about friends. And some of us don't have friends at all. Some of us don't have nobody to be a friend. Pastor, why is that? I'm glad you asked. Because you rude. You mean. You're nasty. You controlling. You unruly. You're not faithful. You're, oh, my favorite one. You're not even loyal. And you want to know why somebody want to hang out with you? Don't nobody want to hang out with your ugly self. You unruly. You mean. Somebody, why about you? Good morning. Praise the Lord. What's good about it? What? Then we want to get in here. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Girl, sit down. Your mean self. You wonder why nobody asks you to greet. Why? You're going to run the people away with your nasty attitude. The stank look on your face. I don't want you to walk nobody. Good morning, praise the Lord. I don't want to go to this church. I'm going to go somewhere else down the road. Do you not know when you greet God's people, you are on the front line for the whole house? I don't know about open fire because, you know, y'all got it going on over here. Servitude is off the chain. I want to tell you guys, thank you. From the text message to the hotel room for each night, you guys did an awesome job. But don't just let it be when it's style conference time. Let it be 24/7. When the person walk off the street, let them feel the love of your leaders. See, that's the problem. We walk around. I know where I am. I'm going back. I just got to put a footnote right there. The problem is this. You standing outside with your stank face, and they're thinking that your pastors have stank face. Your attitude nasty, so they think your leader attitude nasty. You're not approachable, so they think your pastor's not approachable. And we wonder why people are not coming in like they're supposed to. Maybe it's you. And I'm going to speak on the behalf of a pastor. We're crying, we're praying, we're prostrating, we're laboring before God. We're asking God, what are we doing wrong? What are we not saying? And all along, we're delivering the word, but it's the ones that go out before us. And the sad part about it is 90% of the church is women. We want to have cliques. I'm going to get back to check your friendship, but I got to say what I hear. We want to have cliques. We want to be the first one to get next to co-pastor or pastor. Then we want to talk on their behalf. Don't speak for me. Stop talking for me. I can hear the Lord. They're not going to like that. You don't know what I like. Get all the way deep. know what I like. I'm going to get back to my message. We're talking about friendship. But we got to have friendship in the kingdom. You got to have a healthy relationship in the kingdom. You saying your relationship is healthy with God, but you mean as the devil. The devil is a lie. I don't know what God you serving. Because my God is love. He's patient. He's gentle. Do we not know the fruit of the Spirit? It's the small things that run people away when they're hurting. Oh, but I'm getting back to my message. Footnote. Every now and then God gives me a little footnote. So, with your mean self, I got scripture for you too. I had to go into the easy to read version because I really want you to understand what is being said. See, easy to read and the Message Bible, we roll real tight. Them my friends. Proverbs 22, 24 and 25. In the easy to read version, it says this. Don't be friends with people who become angry easily. It says, don't stay around quick-tempered people. If you do, you may learn to be like them. Watch your company. You may learn to be like them, and then you will have the same problem they do. It's easy to read. It's like Prego. It's in there. You wonder why? Don't nobody want to fool with you? You heard the old saying, bird of a feather flocks together. So I ain't going to talk to you because you talk to her. And she ugly. She's nasty. And you can be sweet as pie, but because of what you're hanging around, it makes me feel like you the same way. That's your friend. I don't need you to be my friend. Because I don't need you to go back and tell your friend none of my business. That's what happens. But I'm so glad Lazarus had a friend. Jesus had a friend. His name was Lazarus. We all know the story about Lazarus and how he died and God hung out for a couple of extra days to go back and get him. And he was talking about the resurrection. But I want to talk about the part that nobody talks about. And that's the part where Jesus and Lazarus was cool. The Bible said it was his dear friend. They were real cool. That means Jesus went and told Lazarus some inner parts of him. And Lazarus told Jesus some inner parts of him. Uh-huh. We don't talk about that part. That means Lazarus and Jesus sat down and broke bread. Dear means close. Yes. They were real close. Uh-huh. When Lazarus was sick, Martha and Mary ran and told somebody, hey, go let Jesus know that his friend is sick. They even knew who to go get. If you down and your friend can't come to your rescue, check your friendship. If you need prayer and your friend can't pray, check your friendship. If you broke and your friend got money and she won't give you none, check your friendship. There's no way my daughter is going to be broke and I got $5. I'm going to give her $250. We're going to have $250 and we're going to roll together. Because I value her just that much. I don't make it a bit. I don't make it. Oh, I've come to style on purpose. I come for two reasons. One, to get word. Two, because she's my friend. I come with no motives. I come, I give. I come to sow. I come to be poured into. because she's my friend. You gotta be a friend with no motives. I feel you, Holy Ghost. Friend, no motives. Just be my friend. Don't be my friend because I'm popular. Don't be my friend because I'm cute. Don't be my friend because what I drive. Just be my friend. I'm trying to help you. How can we serve together and we don't like each other? We serving. We praise dancing. We worshiping. We serving. And we don't like each other. Lord, I wish we had a place of liberty was in the house. It just don't happen here. It happened at the Liberty too. But I don't do clicks. And I tell them in a minute, I don't roll like that. We don't get down like that. Either we're going to do or we're going to roll on. Either you're going to serve or sit down. Take your pick. Don't matter to me. I was serving before you got here. Pastor D and I serve when you leave. I was built for this. You got to be built for what God has called you to. Because if you're not built for it, the enemy will play you like a fiddle. I know I'm still talking about friendship, but we're talking about relationship in the kingdom. You cannot be on the same team and don't like your teammate. Do you not know that the enemy sees that? He sees it. That's a loophole for him. And he goes in and he operates. He goes in. And he begins to operate. So I'm going to start division right here. I'm going to start backbiting right here. Oh, when the praise leader get ready to say something, I'm going to act like I don't hear her right here. Oh, now I'm going to outshine you today because I can serve better than you can. He operates. Right there, when there's no unity. Women, we gotta be unified. It's sad that the men can get together and hang out, say whatever they gonna say, hash it out, and walk around like nothing never happened. But us with our petty selves, not only are we petty, but we petty too. We turn into petty bitty. Come on here. We get real sarcastic. Then you have the audacity to pray and don't have no power. I'm just trying to help you. You may be wondering why your prayers are not being answered. Check your relationship. Check how you serve. I had a title, and my title for the message was, check your friendship. Check it. Not just naturally, but check it spiritually. Because see, when God called Lazarus friend, that means that was meant something to him. How many of us mean something to God? When God look at us, can he say, ooh, that's my friend. And we serve him with no motives. We don't have our hands out, but we're seeking his feet. If you seek him, everything else will be added. It says, first seek the kingdom of God and all of his righteousness, and then all these things shall be added unto you. If you seek him, he'll give you a job. If you seek him, he'll give you a house. If you go to work, you can really pay one. Buy one, go to work, get your credit fixed. But if you seek him, he'll get a loved one saved. Quit being so materialistic. It's too much power in this house. Y'all don't understand. I get excited every year when I come to style. Because I get empowered. And I go home with more power. Empowered with more power. Oh, you would catch it on your way going to the house. So, Lazarus, you know, Jesus said, you know what? When he got the message, he was like, okay, cool. I'm going to go. And his disciples, you know, pity bitties. Lord, you going to go over there? And they after you. Girl, why you keep going to that church and they be doing you like that? Shoot, if it was me, that's why I live. You just not going to keep talking to me like that. Before I let you talk to me like that, I leave. That's why I live. And that's why you got so much hell. I'm almost through with my Easter speech. So I'm going to preface this real quick. So Jesus told the disciples, you know, he was like, yeah, you know, in the daytime they can see me, but at nighttime can't nobody see me. So I'm going to move at night because I know they coming for me. He already knew. But when you're a real friend, you're going to go get your friend when your friend is in time of need. Whether you like me or not, I'm coming for my friend. So if your friend can't come for you when you need them, you might want to check your friendship. Jesus was wise with it. He waited a couple of days. So now Martha and Mary real mad. They mad. We done sent for Jesus and Jesus didn't even show up at one time yet. If you would have stayed and kept your ends in a seat, God would have fixed your problem. But because it looked like where you come from, you don't want to deal with it. So we jump up and we leave. But Jesus waited. And he went and he met him in a city right before he was where Lazarus was. And so he sent for Martha. And Martha came where he was. And she was like, God, if you would have been here, my brother wouldn't be dead. And he like, he ain't dead, he's asleep. That's all they doing. Even the disciples was like, if he's asleep, he can wake up. You so, all right then, whatever. If your friend can't wake you out of the state that you in, what kind of friend do you have? If I'm in a dead state and you can't give me life, what good are you as my friend? I'm about to take my own life. And you can't discern where I am? I don't care. I don't care what it looks like. I don't care who likes you. But you said you was my friend. You said we had relationship. You said we had covenant. And you can't meet me in my time of need. But we're friends. Jesus said, take me to him. Where he at? I'm going to show you. See, Mary and Martha had pity. They, oh, woe is me. They even had the mourners. When they cried, they cried. Get away from me with that stuff. I need a friend that's going to tell me, girl, get yourself together. Wipe your tears. Draw your shoulders back up and come on here. Don't you cry with me. I give you a couple of days. But after that third day, you better come on here. better come on.
Yes.
You just not finna sit here and die on me. I'm gonna give you two. But that third one, I'm coming for you. Whether you like me or not. If I gotta dress you, I'll dress you. If I gotta bathe you, I'ma bathe you. But you getting up out of this. I'ma pull you out. Because we supposed to be friends. They already know. At the Liberty, you got 2 days. If you ain't got yourself together by then, I'm either making a phone call or I'm knocking on your front door. You better ask them. They standing over there. Because if we in this together, I dare not let you die. Yeah. You ain't finna die on me. If you gonna die, change your membership. Because there's life over here and more abundantly. God says, I come that you may have life and have it more abundantly. So if I'm a daughter of the King, I should be able to speak life back into you. Still talking about friendship. So God told him, take me. So all of them going, the mourners, all of them. They crying, everybody going. I don't see how God did it because I've been telling all of y'all, shut up. Y'all getting on my last nerve with all this unnecessary crying. I told y'all he's asleep. Real deep. So he told him to remove the grave. And he called his friend forth. Lazarus, come forth. When was the last time you called your friend forth? She ain't gotta be here, but you calling her forth. He ain't gotta be here, but you called him forth. You told him to come out of the state that you're in. You calling it forth. You're casting down every imagination that sought itself against him. Come forth. Calling them forth. Can't serve me on the praise team and you're about to die. I don't know why I'm stuck on the praise team. But the praise team is the front line. It's either going to bring life or it's going to bring death. The praise team sets the atmosphere. You just don't set an atmosphere at church, but you should set an atmosphere everywhere you go. You're supposed to make the atmosphere become conducive to who you are. What are you setting? Are you setting foolery? Or are you setting love, joy, peace? I should be able to go in the midst of my friend and get peace when I got chaos. And a real friend should be able to discern when I'm chaotic. And don't hold it against me. Don't look at me like I'm crazy. But see, this was the thing. He called Lazarus forth, but Lazarus was still bound. He had all them grave clothes still on him. He told them, loose him and let him go. I know it's unorthodox to teach it this way, but I wanted y'all to understand the love that God had for Lazarus. He knew his friend was in a state that he needed help, so he had to go and rescue his friend. He couldn't do it by himself. He had died. Well, they said he was asleep. What kind of friend of you, if you know your friend is dying and you're not there to help them? It shouldn't be the leader's job. It shouldn't be the leader's job to restore everybody. The Bible says he that is spiritual restores such. So if you're spiritual, you should be able to restore me. I shouldn't have to always go to my pastor to be restored. I should be able to go to my sister and get restored. I should be able to go to my friend and be restored, because we have a relationship. I shouldn't have to always go to her or Dr. Coffee or Pastor D. It should be something that we cannot handle before we go to our leaders. This petty mess, oh, she don't like me. That's bull crap. Oh, they won't let me lead a song. God, don't care. So what? You don't go to work crying when you can't have your way. You just go in there and do your job. Because you got a work relationship. You expect for them, they expect for you to do your job. You expect for them to get your paycheck. That's what I did. So same thing here. I expect for you to surrender your service, and God, in return, you expect for God to bless you. That's it. That's all. It shouldn't matter about nothing else. Nothing else matters. But we want to walk around here, woe is me, woe is my. That's what petty mean. Sorrowful. What are you sorry for? Did you wake up this morning? Are you breathing? That alone should give you enough to rejoice. So that you can come into the house of the Lord and be empowered. To get power. Everybody else getting it and you wondering why you ain't got it. Because you won't let this mess go. Sad to say, deliverance took place 2 nights in a row. Powerful word both nights. Somebody still left out of here with no power. Still left out of here with nothing. Ain't gonna come in here on Sunday. Y'all need to look at them and say, take that mess somewhere else. We're not dealing with that today. That's what we need to do. We need to build a coalition. We're not having no petty today. We're not. No. This is the non-petty crew. We're not petty. Not today. We ain't got no pity party. None of that today. We're the non-petty pity party crew. That's our name today. Not today. I ain't trying to be funny. I don't mean to be ugly. I ain't trying to be rude. But if you got a woe is me situation, take it somewhere else. Not today. Leave it in your car. Pick it up when you get back in there. Hopefully by the time you get to your car, you won't have it there no more because you got delivered. You know, because I was low-key mad about this. I'm like, she want me to talk about relationship? I even told Liz, I said, she don't even understand. This is what I be upset about this stuff. I done got in trouble plenty of times with my mommy. I'd be like, mama, this, I'm growing. I didn't say that word. Them good people. I'd be like, mama, they about to get on my last nerve. I went off on everybody. And she'd be like, my dear. T, you can't be going off on the people. Fine then. It takes too much energy to deal with pettiness. You suck the life out of us. I'm sorry, but I gotta talk on the behalf of my pastor friends. You suck the life out of us. You make our jobs hard. frustrating. Because we're supposed to be excited to come and give you life, give you bread. This is not the typical job. It's stressful enough because we're held accountable for your soul. Not just two or three of y'all, but all of y'all. And then for you to come and pull this crap on us, it drains us. It makes us get to the point where we don't even have time for our own families because we're so drained with your pity parties and your pettiness. We're drained with it because you don't want to be mature women and grow up. Even in your marriages. Might as well step on in while I'm out there. I'm out here now. Even in your marriage. Y'all got perfect examples of marriage. I love how she loves Pastor Coffee. And I love how he loves her back. I told my husband, I say, she represents him well. He's gone and don't have a care in the world because she knows she's gonna take care of it. How many of your husbands can say that about you? I'm still out here. I'm going to swim. I'm gonna say my Easter speech and I'm going back to Mesquite. How much time I got? I gotta be respectful. But your husbands, some of y'all been married 12 times. And divorced from every last one of them. When I get married, shut up. God done blessed you 12 times. And you still ain't discovered it's you. And your dumb stuff. Pastor D, and they pettiness. And they pity. And you ask them, girl, what happened? Why did you get divorced? I just fell out of love. No, you didn't. You was in love for the wrong reasons. You didn't have friendship. You had relationship. Relationship comes and goes. But friendship stays until the end. When you're married, you build a friendship. That's my best friend. There's nothing that I can't tell him. There's nothing that he can't tell me. That's my homeboy. I got friendship and relationship. When I need him, I can depend on him. When I need a friend, I got a friend. Some of y'all just got relationship. Well, I want my marriage to be like Pastor Calvin and them. We'll go through what they went through. You want that kind of friendship? Deal with what she dealt with. I done heard a little bit of testimony. I'm good. No, thank you. I'll just be like, ooh, that's so cute. Lord, I thank you. It ain't me. Yeah, I'm good. But it's the friendship that they have. The reason why their marriage is so beautiful. When we go out on a date, we ain't talking about no bills. I'm not talking about kids. I don't care about none of them. I'd be like, where we going? Do I need to put my Chucks and jeans on or do I need to get real cute? What we doing today? Yes, sir. It's not about no bills. It's not about the kids. I don't care what Jordan done. I don't want to hear none of that. None of it. It's about me and you. It's our friendship. Because I've learned kids will get grown and they gonna leave you. You done put your marriage around your children. Now your kids are gone. You sleeping in one room and he in another. Because y'all have no friendship. And you have no relationship. And you only come together so often and then twain and then get up and go back to your room. The devil is a bald-headed fool. I dare not. I wish you would. 25 years to the same man, the only man. And I'm believing God for 25 more. Am I perfect? No. Do I do everything right? Probably don't. Do I get on his nerve? Uh-huh. All the time. He probably be excited when it's time for him to go to work. I got 8 hours without her. 8 hours. No. But let him not call me throughout the day. I got a whole attitude. I get real mad. I mean, I want all the explanations. Why you didn't call? You normally call at this time. What happened? My day don't go well if I, and yeah, I sure did. But when you got a friendship, you look for that phone call. Don't mess up the routine, partner. I'll call him. Boy, I ain't heard from you today. What's up? Come on here. Well, I was busy. Okay, let that be the reason. Go on and make that money, honey. I ain't mad. But we have a friendship. Some of y'all real offended. I don't care. It's all right. I'm going to go on back to Mesquite, to my little people, and we're going to have a good time. But it is important that you understand the power of friendship. Not just naturally, but spiritually. If your friend is not spiritual, when you need them to be spiritual, you need to check your friendship. If you can't serve from a pure heart, you don't need to serve at all. Because where God is taking us in this hour, we don't have time for pity. We don't have time for pity. Because there's a people that is coming that is not of this fold. And it's going to take all of us that are spiritual to restore them. Everything is being taught now. All kind of crazy stuff. What do you mean you don't believe in the Old Testament? You got to eat the whole scroll, the new and the old. My husband was telling me the other day, now they out there talking about they don't believe in paying tithes. The devil. It's principles. Because it's in the Old Testament. But it's godly principles to this thing. And if we are a church full of chaos, what are they going to see when they walk through those doors? Not just y'all's, but ours too. It is important that we just don't come together when we got something big going on. But we come together all the time. It may not be here at Open Fire, but at Place of Liberty, we had that stuff. And I nip it in the bud. So stop getting mad at your leader when they call y'all out. Because you're being petty. Or pity. Get yourself together. Get it together. Play me something soft. Please. Hey, y'all. It is so important that we do better as women. Because we need to make sure that when we become a friend, we are a friend from a pure heart with no motives. Pastor Coffey, you don't even understand. I was telling Pastor Prophetess Stephanie, it felt so good to sit at a table with a group of women and be normal. I didn't have time to be deep. I didn't care, y'all. I mean, it was like I had my tennis shoes on and my blue jean. I didn't have to put all them contraptions on. It felt good. And then to feel the genuine love, mommy, with no motives. Because we go in and out of places and we have to put on this facade already. And we have to walk with our nose held up and act like we really know the word. Because you want to size me up by how I look. Oh, we do it. Oh, we do it. We do it. She don't look like me, so she ain't got no power. Girl, please. She don't dress like me, so she don't know nothing. Girl, hush. I like it when they size me up. I come in here looking like this on purpose sometimes. Because servitude don't bother me. I can sit in the back and still feel the Lord. Or I can sit in the front and still feel God. In my gym tennis shoes and Van tennis shoes. See, I'm real fancy because I put the glitter ones on today. But it doesn't matter. Ladies, let's quit sizing each other up. If you don't like the way I dress, take me to the store and buy me something. But then when you buy it, don't go back and talk about me. Because I was fine with what I had on. If you don't like my hair, get it fixed. When it was something I didn't like, I fixed it. Didn't nobody have to know I fixed it. I just fixed it. Girl, walk on in there. Won't nobody know unless you tell it. I've been holding this testimony, and I'm coming to my close. And I got to tell it. And my husband kept saying, I don't know why you won't tell them what the goodness of the Lord, all the stuff you done, what God done for you. But I was without a car for 3 years, y'all. 3 years. I ain't have no car. We have a car. We have two. But my husband had to get to work. And my son had to get to work. So I ain't have no car. And my husband be like, well, babe, we can take the money and do it. No, we got other stuff to do. You know, don't worry about it. When the time comes, I know God gonna make a way. I got this. I'm not mad. I just wait. See, one thing I love about my husband is he knows if I want something, he's gonna go and make it happen. I don't have to pressure him about it. I don't have to nag him about it. I just say, baby, I won't. He'd be like, okay. That's all. Sometimes just shut up and be quiet. That was a footnote. Tell him what you want and just be quiet. He hear you, but he don't hear you when you start nagging. He don't hear you. So he was like, well, baby, we can do this and we can do that and we can do this. And I was like, no, don't worry about it. We're going to put it into the church because we're believing God for some stuff. You know? So I'm going to take this sacrifice. 3 years. Mommy, no. 3 years. Without a car. Because I gave my car to my son when he graduated high school. And he was going to college. I didn't want my baby down there without a ride. So I gave him my car. And so I was like, I'm good. I'm good. And Mother's Day. That That's why it's so important to be faithful. Because God will meet your need when you just leave it in his hands. See, it's our job to believe. It's his job to do the outcome. Mother's Day came, and they handed me a box. And inside the box was some Laffy Taffys. I love Laffy Taffys. And up under the Laffy Taffys was another box. And I'm like, what are y'all doing with all these boxes? So I thought I had a bunch of gift cards. You know, thought I had some Starbucks and some Ashley Stewart's, you know, all them wonderful people. And when I opened up that box, it was a set of keys to an infinity. M35. But watch this, it wasn't my husband that did it. It was my daughter that did it. But this was the kicker. She was in need of a car herself. She needed a car. They only had one car. So I would take the car from my son so that we can go get the grandbabies from school every day. And if she needed to go do stuff because she owned her own business, take the car. She was in need of a car herself. And I watched how her and her husband sow. I watched her and her husband give. And I kept saying, God, I need you to bless my baby. I need you to give her a car so that she's able to do what she desires to do. And she was looking for a car, and deals kept falling through because we don't believe in car notes. We have ownership because it gives us opportunity to give. Frees us up. And so she took me. She said, Mommy, can you take me so I can go get this car? I'm going to go, take me to go look at this car. And I was like, yeah, girl, come on, I'll take you to go look at it. Still didn't have a car yet, though, remember? And she walked out of there with a BMW. I was like, you better drive, girl. Look at her go. But this was the part that brought me to my knees. Before she paid for her car, her and my husband had already purchased mine. She could have took the money and bought her own first and then thought about me. But she paid attention to godly principles. She took care of her leader, her mom, and then took care of herself. I'm saying all that to say this. Stop worrying about what somebody don't like about you. Because the moment you take care of God's business, God will take care of your business. From a sincere heart. So I encourage y'all, don't leave out of here without being empowered. I don't care if you gotta come to this altar and lay some things on the line, or if you need to go to somebody and restore your friendship. That may be where your destiny lies. You don't know who holds your destiny in their hand. So if you done messed up a relationship that should never been messed up, I encourage you to go fix it. And we're standing on our feet. Father God, we thank you on tonight, this morning, oh God. I pray that something was said, oh God, that would help the women to be empowered. No longer will we be petty or pity, oh God, but will we strive to be powerful, that we'll go and dig our sisters up when they're down, oh God, and we'll remove the grave clothes off of them. Yes, shatamaso. And command for them to come forward with life. Father, accept our sacrifice of worship as we give glory back unto you, oh God. And God, we thank you for what you're getting ready to do. Father, we thank you for what you have already done. God, we thank you for the miracles and the signs and the wonders that's getting ready to take place. God, we thank you for new relationships, Father. God, we thank you for new business relationships, oh God. God, we thank you for new friendships from a pure place, Father, right now in the name of Jesus. Father, we even thank you for the new members that are coming with an open mind to serve, with a heart to give unto your people. And God, we give you glory for it. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, bless God. Come on, people of God, let's give another hand clap of praise.